So now we're going to start our course. So first, we're going to discuss about the DNA preservation. So before we conduct any study, if you want to study the DNA, we need to collect the organism, and then we have to preserve the organism so that the DNA will be intact for the further analysis. So after this lecture, you should be able to first to know the procedure to collect biological samples for DNA study. So you have to know the procedure and also understand the principle and the method of the DNA preservation. So the procedure for the DNA preservation. So first you have to collect sample. After you collect the sample, you have to remove the tissue. So for example, if you want to get the DNA from an elephant, so you have to collect the elephant, okay? But you don't need the entire animal for the study. So you have to remove some of the tissue from the animal. And then after that, you have to document the sample, you have to label them properly and note down all the required information. After that, then you have to choose a method, preservation method, to preserve the tissue and the DNA. So the objective is to first, you have to make sure you obtain the correct taxa, and you have to make sure you obtain enough DNA from organism, and you also want to minimize other compound in the organism that could damage the DNA, and you want to reduce the contamination. So you only want the DNA from the organism or from the sample that you want to study, and you try to avoid the contamination of your sample by the DNA from other sources. Okay, so see what we call the foreign DNA. So to collect the sample, so the sample is usually we refer to the organism, so it can be plant or animal. Okay. So first you have to determine the taxa for the research, which species or which family or which genera that you want to study. So your research unit can be individual, species level, genera level, or family level. And you also have to decide how many samples you want to collect. And you want to collect the sample from the field or stock center. So the stock center, for example, is a nursery museum collection. So if you can find the samples there, and the samples information, like a location, is available, then you can use the sample from the museum. So if you have to do the sampling, you can use the direct sampling method or indirect sampling method. So it really depends on the research questions and also the organism. So the direct sampling method is what we call the invasive sampling. The indirect sampling method is what we call the non-invasive sampling. So for direct sampling, you have to find and collect the organism. So you have a direct contact with the organism. For the non-invasive sampling, you will not directly contact with the organism. So for the invasive sampling, you have to manipulate the organism. So you might catch, trap, or collect the organism. So you have learned all these things in the other course. However, many organisms cannot be collected directly. For example, protected species. So you're not allowed to harm the species, especially the protected species. Or maybe the organism is very hard to find, but somehow you still can get their DNA. It's very difficult to catch, and sometimes you don't even know what is your target organism. So for example, In this case, those organisms that is very hard to find, see, and catch. But in any case, they might leave the trace of the DNA in the environment. Okay, so for example, you might get the DNA from their stool sample, okay, their fecal sample. So it's still possible even though you didn't see the animal. And sometimes you don't even know what is the target organism. So let's say you want to study the parasite in an animal. So in this case, you don't really know which parasite. So usually you just get the blood sample and hopefully and extract the DNA from the blood sample. And if there's a parasite in the blood sample, probably you also can extract the DNA of the parasite together with the DNA of the host. So you, for the indirect sampling, non-invasive, you might collect the hair or fur of the animal. You might collect the feces, okay, and the parasite. So I give you a few examples. So I would like to show you the one of the videos. So this video is a project named the Halimau Selamanya. It's a project that conducted by Rimba. So I play the video, so you just look at it and then try to observe and think what this tiger was doing. Actually, what you see here, what is on the tree is a fur trap. Okay, so they put the pheromone, the hormone, on the trap, and when the tiger scratch their back on the tree, then the hair will trap on this device. And for the hair, so hopefully when the hair was detached from the animal, so this is the hair, hopefully there's a follicle where you can get some cells, and in the cell you can get the DNA of the tiger. So in this case, you don't need to trap the tiger, you don't have to have a direct contact with the tiger, but you still can get the DNA of the tiger. So this is another project by Rimba. So for example, this is a flying foxes. Okay. So if you want to conduct a population study, you want to get the DNA from many individuals from a population. And in this case, if you want to get the DNA from these flying foxes, if you want to get the DNA directly from the animal, then you have to bring the animal down from the tree. And in this case, if you really want to do that, you might harm the animal. So one way to do it is to collect the feces, okay, and then get the DNA from the feces, because the feces has passed through the digestive system, the intestine and things like that. So there might be some cells left over in the feces sample. So another way to collect it is to collect the blood sample from the parasite or fly. Okay. So for example, this fly, they suck the blood from the animal. So what you can do is just get the flies and extract the blood sample from the flies, and you can also get the DNA of the mammal or animal.